Last time we have seen large number of impeller designs, and we classified them into three categories. So the considerations were closed clearance impellers and open impellers. And in closed clearance, we saw paddles, anchors, single helical, double helical, helical screw ribbon, and gates. These were the impellers under closed clearance category. Whereas in open category, there were plenty impellers, the disk turbine, and many. The other category was on the basis of the direction of flow that the impeller generates. So radial flow impellers, we saw 6-7 designs under that. Axial flow impellers, we saw many more designs. Tangential flow impellers are basically closed clearance impellers other than the helical ribbon. The third category which we saw, if I remember, but otherwise I will start with that today, that is flow generating impellers versus turbulence generating impellers. The overall power is given by NP, rho, N cube, D raised to 5, which we split into two, N cube, ND cube, into NP by N cube, rho, N square D. So NQ, good. Very good. And turbulence. The third method of classification is flow generating impellers versus turbulence generating impellers. What is done here, this means 85% up to 90% the impeller generates flow, this combination that we have written, and 10% to 15% turbulence, whereas here 85% to 90% turbulence and 10% flow. So we start with gate and all types of helical ribbons, followed by anchor, followed by axial and radial propellers and hydrofoils. We have seen the entire family of pitch blade turbines. We said that depending upon number of blades, width of the blade, width at the hub and width at the tip, angle at the hub and angle at the tip, the power number keeps on changing. The six bladed we saw, four bladed we saw, and then when the width decreases from hub to tip, then it becomes more and more flow generating impeller. Or if the angle at the hub is 45 and if we twist it, then the projected area more or less remains the same. Projected area multiplied by the local speed at that point, and therefore flow is generated uniformly right from center up to wall. Can I request all of you to keep silence? I think there are only two groups who have something urgent to talk to each other. They need not go out. Maybe they can sit here separately. I am able to see them. They are not able to see me because they are busy with something. Do you remember all these impellers? Perhaps homogenizers I did not explain, but this turbine, when disc is converted into, the gas foil and CD6, they should change. When that straight blunt blade is converted into half circle, that is called CD6. When it is converted to parabola, then that is called gas foil. So this is parabola, then curved blade turbine, pitch blade turbines, all the categories, hydrofoils, and all these impellers. So three classifications: closed clearance impellers versus open impellers, then radial axial tangential flow impellers, and turbulence generating impellers versus the flow generating impellers. In industry, typically there are five applications or six applications. The first one, the last one I did not explain to you. The homogenizers, these are the impellers where the viscosity of the material is very high and power consumption per unit volume of the material is very, very high, maybe of the order of 1000 kilowatts per meter cube and even more than that. Typically, I gave you some numbers last time, if I remember correctly. For mixing and blending, I said some number. Did I give these numbers? Mixing and blending. Then I said heat transfer. Then solid suspension. Then gas liquid dispersion. Then liquid-liquid dispersion. Do you have those numbers? The notebook is different. Anybody having? Did I announce this in the class? I'm going to tell you some thumb rules, which are very useful. Mixing and blending, the application number one, is there are two liquids which are anyway miscible with each other, but they are to be homogenized. That is application number one. That is, say, dilution of sulfuric acid with water, such examples. So for these cases, depending upon density difference, the power consumption per unit volume, when we say per unit volume, means volume of both the liquids put together in the stirred tank. So the power consumption per unit volume is of the order of 0.1 to 1 kilowatt per meter cube. Right. The second application, which is flow controlled operation. So if we take pitch blade turbines, it means that depending upon the location, it can be 50% flow, 50% turbulence. Whereas if you go to disk turbine, it is 80% turbulence, 20% flow. So all these up to hydrofoil and pitch blade turbines with angle of say 30 degrees are twisted blades. These are flow impellers. So for blending, mixing, the power consumption range is 0.1 to 1. Somehow I feel I have done this, but anyway. Two is heat transfer. Three solid suspension. So all kinds of formulations like creams and pastes, material which looks in a similar manner. The homogenization means anyway these are something immiscible with each other, but with the help of surfactants and at very high power consumption, they are broken down into smaller and smaller particles. And surface active agents keep them stable, one phase particles into another. And in some of the creams, you might have noticed that the phase separation occurs. even in lotions, but then the improvements are made in terms of surface active agents so that the phase separation doesn't occur. But the power consumption required is very high. So for heat transfer, this is 0.2. to 1.2, 0.5 to 2, gas liquid dispersion, 2 to 10, liquid dispersion, 100. Now I have given this thumb rule, but see what is the meaning. If it is gas liquid dispersion, it is in the range of 2 to 10. Now this is a very wide range. Though it is a thumb rule, whether 2 is to be used, 2.5, 3 or 3.5, there is a question mark, no? So, the clarity in the selection of power consumption always comes from financial calculations. I had discussed this before. Let me do that again. Suppose there is gas liquid dispersion. We are carrying out oxidation of paraxylene to terthalic acid. That is CH3 are in para position, and each CH3 group is to be converted into COOH. And terthalic acid is a monomer for polyester. Right. Now here oxidation is carried out using air. So paraxylene comes in, there is an oxidation reaction. Of course there is a mass transfer of oxygen into the paraxylene, and then there is a chemical reaction of paraxylene oxidation and we get a product. Now try to understand, if we use the power consumption of 2, anyway I am going to tell you how to calculate the minimum power consumption for gas liquid dispersion. What are the criteria which govern the minimum power consumption? And that is of the order of 2 to 2.5. But after 2.5, there is a certain bubble size at that power consumption. There is a certain interfacial area and there is a certain mass transfer coefficient. Right. So that governs the rate of transfer of oxygen from gas phase to liquid phase. If the power consumption is increased to 3 or 4 or 5 or keep on increasing up to 10, the mass transfer coefficient increases. This means when the rate of oxygen transfer increases, the size of the reactor comes down. So what we need to do, this exercise you should be doing when you are designing the stirred tank reactor in your home paper, but that you can do now also. That is, for every power consumption, how to get mass transfer coefficient, that is our chapter number 4. Having obtained mass transfer coefficient, since it is a combination of mass transfer with chemical reaction, overall rate of mass transfer, this is our, of course, the chapter number 2, how to get the rate controlling step. But obviously, let us say with the help of common sense, that as the power consumption increases, the bubble size goes down, interfacial area increases, the holdup increases, mass transfer coefficient increases, and the equipment size comes down. So on one side, the power consumption or the electricity bill increases, on the other side, the capital cost increases. So for every power consumption we calculate, we size the stirred tank reactor and compare Have you completed chemical engineering economics? Has it started? This is your last semester, no? You are in third.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Maybe very, very briefly, I'll tell you. Suppose stud tank we designed and material of construction is stainless steel. So what we do is we calculate the volume on the basis of the rate that we calculate, and there is a certain rate of production. The rate we calculate is always kilomoles per meter cube second, and the production rate is kilomoles per second. So kilomoles per second divided by kilomoles per meter cube second, whatever I am telling you just now, you need not understand. It's not required, because I am going to teach you again in much greater detail. I'm just telling you as an overall strategy what is done in industry. So the kilomoles per meter cube second, the volumetric rate of reaction or volumetric rate of absorption keeps on increasing with power consumption, and the volume of reactor goes down. So suppose there is a certain volume of the reactor. This means there is a certain diameter, there is a straight height, and there are dished ends. Then we tried to find out, that also perhaps you have not done, pressure vessel design, finding the thickness of the P times D times divided by 2 times, you have done that, right? So depending upon pressure of operation, we find the thickness, to which we add corrosion allowance. So when the thickness is known, say it is 10 millimeters, diameter is known, perimeter can be calculated, the overall metal requirement in terms of volume or weight, it can be calculated. Then this is the only raw material part of it, on top of which there are the fabrication expenses. And fabrication expenses are divided into many sub-factors. One is, there is a certain sheet available in the market, 2 meters, 3 meters, 6 meters, and then if you have any size specified, then some material gets wasted. Right. So that is part number one. Then certain labor is required. Then certain dishing or making cylindrical shape. So there are machines which give, for a straight sheet, a cylindrical shape is given. So no fabrication happens in one shop. There is a dishing shop, they do only dishing. Some other people, they do only cylindrical portion. And then welding, etc. So for stainless steel type of material, which is very widely used, whatever material cost we get, we add 50% as a thumb rule, and that becomes the cost of fabricated equipment. So using this procedure, we get say 50 lakh rupees. And for this, and the volume is say 20 meter cube. Now we are comparing, now 20 meter cube, if we keep 2 kilowatts per meter cube, 20 meter cube means 40 kilowatts. Right? And 40 kilowatts is run for 8,000 hours. And the cost per unit kilowatt hour is 10 rupees. Just calculate. 2 kilowatt per meter cube, 20 meter cube. Number of hours for which we keep the stirred tank in operation are 8,000 hours per year. So 2 into 20 into 8,000 into 10 rupees per kilowatt hour. How much is total money? Thirty-two lakhs? Yeah. And the cost of equipment is, say, 50 lakh rupees. No, we don't add like that. The equipment has a life. If there is highly corroding atmosphere, then we may take life of, say, even 1 year or 2 years. If it is non-corrosive atmosphere, then the life can be 10 years or 15 years. If the life is 10 years, the annualized cost of that stirred tank reactor is 50 upon 10. So 5 lakh is the cost of the equipment, and which is called annualized cost. And then we calculate total cost as 32 plus 5 is equal to 37. All right? Now, if we increase the power consumption to, say, 10 kilowatt, and the volume goes down to 4 meter cube, and the cost comes down to 10 lakh rupees, right? So when it is 10 lakh rupees and again life is 10 years, then annualized cost is 1 rupee. Whereas 10 kilowatts per meter cube, calculate with new volume. What is the new volume? Did I say 2 meter cube? 4 meter cube, okay. So 10 into 4 into 8,000 into 10. How much? 30. Again 32 lakhs? Okay. And then the cost of the equipment I mentioned to you, 10 lakh. So 10% of that, so it becomes 32 plus 1, 33 rupees. 33 lakhs. So using 10 kilowatts is more preferred option as compared to 2 kilowatts. So it depends from location to location. The cost of electricity depends from location to location. The stainless steel price, if you go to the places which are remote from cities, then the fabrication prices go down. The cost of stainless steel, it used to be, when I was doing home paper 40 years ago, it used to be 300 rupees per kilogram. It went down 140 rupees, and I understand that now also it is 300 rupees after 45 years. Point is, we really calculate cost, try to get annualized cost, and then take the decision. Have you understood this procedure? Yeah. I don't expect you to understand 100%. Have you understood 10%? That is enough today. Because I'm going to come back to this point, perhaps again and again, for taking decision. So we play between 2 kilowatt per meter cube to 10 kilowatt per meter cube, try to find out annualized cost, and then try to take decision. So these are the typical numbers, and these, the blending and mixing, these three are called flow controlled operations. And these are called the turbulence controlling operations. I'm going to tell you one more thumb rule. So x-axis is viscosity, millipascal per second or centipoise. I'm telling you one more thumb rule. Up to about 5000, so open impellers are used up to viscosity of 5000 centipoise, whereas this is helical ribbon. Obviously, the power number of helical ribbon, double helical ribbon will be more than single helical ribbon. Double helical ribbon with screw will be even more than. So suppose we take a decision of increasing power consumption, we keep on increasing the power number. If you see anchor, so anchors are very commonly employed, but now it is proved beyond doubt that the maximum efficiency that it can give is 70-75%. So if we take a conclusion from here that within the category of close clearance impellers, we use only helical ribbons. Why do we need close clearance impellers? One obvious reason is the viscosity is more than 5000, and the open impellers, then they try to rotate in the central region and the entire domain is not under mixing. Particularly if the liquid is non-Newtonian, then when the it is shear thinning liquid, the shear rate is maximum in the vicinity of impeller, the viscosity is less, and the impeller moves only in the central region. So for all those cases more than 5000, we use close clearance impeller and helical ribbon. Another application, I'm telling you very qualitatively, only thumb rules. Only thumb rules. Whenever heat transfer occurs, it is a good idea to have maximum flow where heat transfer is occurring. Right, no? And if we are we have provided a jacket, then the heat transfer area is the wall of the vessel. And if we keep maximum velocity near the wall, and that happens only in the case of closed clearance impellers. So for heat transfer, particularly if it is, say, crystallization, or because of any reason, there are suspended solids, and there is a possibility when there is a crystallization and we try to evaporate, right? We want to evaporate. Suppose we want to make sodium chloride crystals. So dilute solution, we make it concentrated, and as we concentrate, the maximum temperature is near the wall. Where crystallization occurs, there is a deposition layer on the wall, and that reduces the heat transfer. So in all crystallizations and all suspensions, wherever the heat transfer is there, then there is an additional resistance of solid deposition on the wall and reduction in heat transfer. So all those cases also, so I mentioned two cases, viscosity more than 5000 and wherever solid suspension and possibility of deposition, then we use closed clearance impellers. Otherwise, we use open impeller. This is a thumb rule that I have given. If you ask me for 5000, if I use open impellers, this is a guideline. Not that it will not operate at all, but the guideline is up to 5000 use open impellers. Normally, in very light language, I say that any design will work, no? Even you put a rod, like or a spoon, in the commercial reactor, eventually it will do the job. But in how many hours? How many days? So we definitely calculate what are the pros and cons, and accordingly, on the basis of experience, we make recommendations. Regarding heat transfer area, there are various ways of providing heat transfer area. One is, of course, maybe I will provide you with good pictures and circulate to you. This is jacket. This is baffle jacket. So the flow cross section, if we take pi by 4 outer diameter square minus inner diameter square, that flow area is very high. And you know that hydraulic diameter is outer diameter minus inner diameter. And whatever is volumetric flow rate, the velocity is low. So these are used only when steam condensation is there. But anyway, this is called jacket. So therefore, here in baffle jacket, the flow moves in a helical manner. So suppose there is an inlet. Here there is an inlet, and then there is some outlet. So here, inlet, the flow goes in helical manner, and then there is an outlet. So in and out, which increases the heat transfer coefficient. Other than that, what is popular in industry, Ray, keep silence. Today's day is little different. Again, there are only two groups. I think I should do some remixing. Those two groups I can mix in the larger audience. And problem will be solved. So those who are making noise, they should take a hint that they are going to get mixed very soon. This is limpet coil. It's a simple, it is a half coil which is welded on the vessel wall in such a way that it forms a helix, and it is called a limpet coil. Other than that, we can have a coil inside. I will provide you nice pictures. There can be a coil inside. There can be two coils. There can be three coils, four, five, depending upon heat of reaction, the enthalpy, the rate of enthalpy to be removed from stir tank, or a rate of enthalpy to be added, that much heat transfer area is required. So take a case of nitration, where the heat of reaction is very large. What I have provided is five coils. Five means there is a coil inside the coil. Then there is yet another coil. We'll provide nice pictures, very good pictures. There is yet another method. Suppose we need very large heat transfer area. So typically, 5 coils can give 30 to 35 meters square per meter cube. Single coil gives maximum 6, 7 meters square per meter cube. 5 coils can give 30, 35. But if we need much more than that, then design a heat exchanger, which is of say 100 meter cube, 200 meter cube. With the help of a pump, use a heat exchanger and then bring it back. In last 10 years, I have designed where the heat requirement was very, very high. The way in which it was done was, suppose this part is heat exchanger. I promised you that I am going to give you pictures, so please attend to whatever I have drawn. This I use for gas liquid dispersion. So there is a gas liquid dispersion inside the main strut tank, and this principle I have explained to you several times. There are impellers inside. And we sparge gas from the bottom, and there is a gas liquid dispersion inside. Say, for example, the gas fraction is 20%. On the other side, there is no gas. And exactly similar to the external loop airlift reactor, the density here of the rho gh, call it as point A, and call this as point B. And rho gh here, the PB is greater than PA. And the liquid starts circulating through heat exchanger. It circulates at the bottom. The gas sparging is done somewhere in the pipe. Which makes PB greater than PA, and self-circulation happens. And we have seen that such circulation velocities are even 3 meters per second, 7 meters per second, which happens because of the natural circulation arising out of density difference. On the other hand, getting pumps of those capacity is very expensive. It is not that simple. But there should be a condition where we can make easily PB greater than PA, which is possible in gas liquid dispersion. If there is no gas liquid dispersion or liquid liquid dispersion because of there is no density difference, then we need to use pump. So only jacket with baffles, then limpet coils. The coils inside, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the external heat exchangers, with pump, without pump, and there are few more ways. You can imagine, and you can, instead of the helical coils, there are vertical coils, and those are put inside, in front of the baffle and the backside of the baffle. I think that picture also we will provide, right? And then there are plate heat exchangers inside, that also. What I am pointing out, the heat transfer area is immersed inside, and that heat transfer area, the shape is in different forms. And what we need to know then later on, which I am going to teach you in chapter 4, for such a hardware, how to get heat transfer coefficient. According to me, that is going to be the most difficult chapter. Right. Because the theories available, the fundamentals of heat and mass transfer, which are known to any chemical engineer in the world, they are so poor that we need empiricism. And whenever there is an empiricism, there are no clear recommendations. There are no clear recommendations. But I'm going to tell you on basis of my own experience, some recommendations, which correlations to be used, which correlations are the recent developments, which are expected to give the better predictions, that I will teach you under the chapter 4. So these are the heat transfer areas. That is yet another methodology. Now, so heat is liberated, and instead of the heat exchanger like this, at the operating temperature, we reduce the pressure. And if the reduction in pressure is equivalent to the boiling point of the material, then the heat generated boils the material and it goes out in the form of a vapor, to which we attach a condenser. We can have a directly mounted condenser. Of any area, so this is called evaporative cooling. Have you understood? No, I spoke very fast, so it is difficult to understand. I'll repeat again. There is some liquid inside, and perhaps the reaction is homogeneous reaction, or it is liquid-liquid reaction, or it is gas-liquid reaction, or gas-liquid-solid reaction. That does not matter. But the reaction is exothermic. The reaction is exothermic. So under these cases, be attentive. Then you will understand quickly, and the number of occasions for which I need to explain, that will come down. The exothermic heat is liberated, and the pressure within the reactor for removing that heat, we adjust in such a way that at that pressure, one of the liquid boils. Right? So when heat is generated at every point within the reactor, the liquid boils there, and that heat transfer is very efficient. And when that vapor goes to the condenser, the condensation of vapor is also efficient. So this direct evaporative cooling is very, very efficient. We should look for the opportunities if there is any solvent. And I have, in my experience, I must have deliberately put in solvent only for heat transfer, which does not take part in the reaction. the job it does, it evaporates, goes up, condenses, comes down, so that the quantity of that material which helps in heat transfer, that remains constant. Have you understood now? No? Some yes, some no. Yes?
Yes, sir.
Once more? No. Okay. Let me provide, are you with the pictures, are we going to provide some description also? We'll provide description also. I'm going to teach you now the mechanism of dispersion of gas into liquid, and then later on mechanism of dispersion of solids into liquid. Let us start with gas, and let me try this, that is with the help of slides, whether I can explain to you. Otherwise, I'll draw all those pictures on the board. We have already, while that adjustment is ongoing, you look at me. I have already told you power consumption is proportional to or equal to power number multiplied by rho n cubed d raised to 5. Now we are discussing gas liquid dispersion. Whenever there is a gas, the average density at any location is the mixture density. And now the impeller rotates in gas liquid dispersion. So as the fraction of gas increases in the vessel, the density that impeller sees that goes down, and therefore the power consumption decreases with an increase in the gas fraction within the vessel. Is that right? So this is a qualitative graph that has been drawn. Power consumption in the presence of gas divided by power consumption in the absence of gas, and x-axis is the how much quantity of gas we are putting in, this is volumetric flow rate of gas in meter cube per second divided by nd cube. N is impeller speed, d is impeller diameter. So as we keep on increasing the volumetric flow rate of gas, the power consumption decreases, and the reason I explained to you, as more and more gas is sparged, the overall density goes down, the impeller now rotates in gas liquid dispersion, the overall density goes down, and as a result the power consumption decreases. Now this particular part, now I'm going to explain to you even more in more detail. Imagine a stirred tank, and there is a sparger at the bottom where bubbles are formed, and there is an impeller. Can you imagine this? A vessel, gas introduction below the impeller, and this is the condition when impeller is not rotating. Impeller is not rotating, the gas is sparged. Since impeller is not rotating, more or less rising bubbles are undisturbed, and they move upwards only in the central region. Right? Now increase the impeller speed. Now the impeller is capable of generating flow and capable of breaking the bubbles generated by the sparger, and gas holdup increases. In other words, the volume occupied by the bubbles it keeps on increasing as the impeller speed increases. So if you see in the next picture, not only they have going of the volume, the radially the volume has increased, but at some locations it has reached the wall. If you increase it further, it has come right up to the impeller, right? So initially, the bubbles passed, they were going only directly upwards. There was no radial movement because impeller speed was zero. There was no radial component of the flow, and bubbles were moving only in axial direction, and no bubble was going into radial direction. As the impeller is started, since it has both the components, axial and radial components, because even if it is actually upward impeller, as the flow goes upwards, then it turns, it becomes radial, and then the flow goes down. So wherever there is radial portion, so the bubbles move upwards directly. As the impeller speed increases, there is a cone, right? Speed increases further, there is more spread, more volume of gas is retained in the liquid because there is now downward flow within the vessel which keeps the impellers, keep on increasing the speed, and then it comes directly up to the impeller. That's what I have shown it here, that this particular condition is called the loading. So there are four words which are assigned in the theory of mixing and practice: loading, flooding, dispersion, and circulation. Right? And all the four terms I'm going to explain to you. So we have come up to here. So this is called loading. If we go still further, then not only you come up to the impeller, as the same impeller speed is increased, the bubbles even come down. They come down and they come up to the bottom of the vessel. Or in other words, this is the condition at which the entire volume within the vessel is useful. Correct? Up to loading, if we see the condition of loading, this volume was without gas liquid dispersion. If you see the condition earlier, then further this much volume is not under gas liquid dispersion. And if you take the condition number one, practically all the volume is not under utilization. Very small volume is utilized. But if we increase the speed further, this is the dispersion where the bubbles. Now this is the condition which is called the critical impeller speed for gas liquid dispersion. We must be using power consumption under which, for that power consumption, bubbles should be available everywhere in the vessel, right up to the any corner, up to the bottom nozzle, at the top, everywhere bubbles should be. That is the mandatory condition, and it is called critical impeller speed for gas liquid dispersion. Or at that impeller speed, there is a certain power consumption, and we say that there is certain critical power consumption for gas liquid dispersion, which is of the order of 2 to 2.5 kilowatt per ton, right? The range which I was describing to you, 2 to 10. And then if you go further, then whatever is the gas which has come up to down, it recirculates back to the impeller, And the gas hold up. The quantity of gas in the vessel keeps on increasing as we go further. So under all these conditions, but if you go backwards, now this is the recirculation condition. Now at the same impeller speed, now you increase the gas flow rate. Up till now what we have done, let me repeat. This is zero impeller speed. This is zero impeller speed. We keep on increasing. The gas fraction increases because as loading, critical dispersion, recirculation, right? Now we keep impeller speed constant and increase the gas flow rate. So as we increase the gas flow rate, the recirculation region goes back to complete dispersion. If you increase the gas flow rate further, it goes to loading condition. If you increase the gas further, so capacity of the impeller to handle that much gas, it keeps on reducing, and recirculation goes to critical dispersion, goes to loading, and goes to eventually, if we increase the gas flow rate to very high value, impeller is unable to do the job. And whenever, say, impeller is unable to do the job of dispersing that much gas, we say that impeller is flooded. So flooding, loading, dispersion, and recirculation. Understood? Silence. Yeah. If there is anybody who is wanting explanation, I'll be very happy. Yeah. I'm going to explain, but can you point out the location at which it was, the explanation was not sufficient? That is increasing gas flow rate instead of increasing the impeller speed, right? After loading, there is critical speed for dispersion, and then there is recirculation. No. This is just one way of looking at it. You keep on increasing impeller speed for given gas flow rate. Right. For another gas flow rate, you keep on increasing speed. Right. I have understood what exactly is your point. Let me give a bigger answer, okay, so that everybody will understand. This is understood. There is a certain gas flow rate. There is a certain gas flow rate, and impeller speed is anyway zero or very low, and impeller is not doing any job, or impeller is not capable of doing job for enhancing the gas holdup within the liquid. But when impeller speed is increased, there is a power introduced by the impeller in the liquid which creates axial and radial components of the flow, and therefore now bubbles can spread even in the radial direction. And therefore now the bubbles, the volume that it has occupied, the bubble concentration has increased. Now increase the speed further, again the volume has increased further. Increase further, the volume has come right up to the impeller. Increase further, they have come up to the bottom. And now the bubble is recirculating, bubbles are recirculating, right? Now this happens, all these conditions happen at every flow rate. So suppose for one particular gas flow rate, there is a critical impeller speed for gas dispersion where bubbles are available everywhere. And if you increase the gas flow rate we make twice, then the critical impeller speed required for dispersion, that increases. Understood? So now the way I'm explaining is like this. That is, it is now recirculating for that given flow rate. Right. Now gas is dispersed, gas is recirculated, and explanation is complete as far as that gas flow rate is concerned. Right. Now you increase the gas flow rate for the same power consumption by the impeller. As the gas flow rate is increased, we get dispersion, we get loading, we get finally a flooding condition, a flooding condition. So for that gas flow rate, now if you increase the impeller speed further, then again same conditions will occur. And the critical impeller speed for gas dispersion, that will increase for that enhanced flow rate. So it is the combination of volumetric flow rate of gas and power consumption provided by the impeller to together decide what is the quality of gas liquid dispersion within the vessel. Is it understood? Yes? Yes? Yeah. There is a next graph which I am going to show you and explain to you. And this is drawn for downflow impeller. This is drawn for downflow impeller. I explained axial flow impellers. So the if flow generated is actually upwards, this is called upflow impeller. If it is actually downwards, then that is called downflow impeller. Is it clear? I think I will draw myself. This is difficult to understand. This is difficult to understand. What it says, as impeller speed is increased, first of all there is an increase, then there is a decrease, there is a maximum, a minima, then there is a maxima, and then again it decreases. And I need to explain this to you in greater detail. So we will take a break, and when we come back, I'll teach this part to you. Okay. But I will not use slide. The slide is difficult to understand. I'll draw myself.